Welcome to Tranent Parish Church for this service of remembrance on Sunday, the 14th of November. We gather today to worship God, to remember with thanksgiving those who have lived and died in the service of our country, to pray for those caught up in conflict today, and to ask for God's help so that we might use wisely the freedom that has been bought at such a price. Our call to worship is from Psalm 46. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth should change, though the mountains shake in the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble with its tumult. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Let us worship God by singing together, Be Thou My Vision. Let us pray. Lord God, you are the shepherd of our souls and the giver of life everlasting. Your purpose is to bring peace on earth as in heaven. You gather us here as your people, in body and spirit, to remember and to be renewed. We trust you with our lives, and we remember your goodness and your power. We remember that you are our maker. You know our frailty and our weakness. And in dark times, you are the giver of light and hope. May we know your presence with us now, in peace, in companionship, and in strength. Help us to be still, Lord, to listen and to hear your voice, and to remember those who have given their lives for us and for others. Help us to be thankful for them, Lord, always. Help us to remember, too, those who were our enemies, who who suffered and who also remember their dead. We remember those who live with the wounds of war, those who have lost faith in you and hope for humanity, yet who are forever held in your care. God of mercy, you have asked us to love each other. We confess that we prefer to love those we like and that we avoid those who we find it hard to be with but who need our care. Lord, we confess that we have not always obeyed you and that we have caused hurt to you and others. Lord, have mercy on us. Forgive our sins. We trust in your constant love for us, your forgiveness and your mercy. Guide us to depend on you and not ourselves, so that we live in your strength and goodness. Help us to remember you each day, to be ready to look for the signs of your kingdom and to speak peace and to live peace too, with all who we meet in our days. In grateful thanks for your care for us, we say together the words which Jesus taught us to say, in whichever words are most familiar to each one of us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Are we ready? Can we be quiet and still as we remember? What are we remembering? We remember the lives lost in battle, in bombings, in hospital beds and trenches. We remember the bravery of the young men who went off to war. They were not ready for the horrors they faced. We remember the women and children left behind, having to get ready for air raids and rationing. We remember those industries getting ready for war, for those making munitions, battle armor, and uniforms. We remember the leaders getting ready for the biggest battle of their lives, taking risks and making decisions that would affect millions of lives. We remember that those who fought, fought for peace, a peace they hoped would last forever. We remember that it is now our turn to get ready, ready to remember the sacrifices of those who have gone before us and those who still fight for peace today. We pause to remember, for we must never forget. A reflection from Spill the Beans. Our next hymn is We Lay Our Broken World.
Our broken world in sorrow and joy, please, our sin, thy hunger, war and fear, oppress thy power.
Our Old Testament reading this morning is read by Connor McFadgen, and our New Testament reading is read by Laurie Brett.
Our reading this morning is taken from Deuteronomy chapter 4, verses 9 to 14, from the New Revised Standard Version. But take care and watch yourselves closely, so as neither to forget the things that your eyes have seen, nor to let them slip from your mind all the days of your life. Make them known to your children and your children's children, how you once stood before the Lord your God at Horeb, when the Lord said to me, "Assemble the people for me, and I will let them hear my words, so that they may learn to fear me as long as they live on earth, and may teach their children so." You approached and stood at the foot of the mountain while the mountain was blazing up to the very heavens, shrouded in dark clouds. Then the Lord spoke to you out of the fire. You heard the sound of words, but saw no form. There was only a voice. He declared to you his covenant, which he charged you to observe, that is, the Ten Commandments, and he wrote them on two stone tablets. And the Lord charged me at that time to teach you statutes and ordinances for you to observe in the land that you are about to cross into and occupy. Amen, and thanks be to God for these readings of his most holy word.
Good morning. Our second reading today is from John chapter 15 at verse 9, and I'm reading from the New Revised Standard Version. As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. I have said these things to you so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. I do not call you servants any longer, because the servant does not know what the master is doing. But I have called you friends because I have made known to you everything that I have heard from my Father. You did not choose me, but I chose you. And I appointed you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, so that the Father will give you whatever you ask him in my name. I am giving you these commands so that you may love one another. Amen. And may God add his blessing to this reading.
Our next hymn is "I Vow to Thee, My Country." This is a Remembrance Day hymn, and please simply listen to the tune from the composer Holst or join in with the words as well.
Oh,
Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable to you, Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. A country heard of but not seen is dreamed of in this hymn, I Vow to Thee, My Country. A country with gentle ways and peaceful paths. A country or a place to live which is longed for and looked for. It is worth a hard, long journey to get there. We may each have our own places which are worth a long, hard journey to get to. Perhaps we may have them now, or we are still to find them, longed for special places in this country. Perhaps a place where we went on holiday as children, maybe to an island far off in the west coast of Scotland, or even further afield abroad in a hot and sunny place. These are places to look forward to going to long for. I think that this is the kind of place that Moses, the great leader, is talking about today in our Old Testament reading. He speaks to God's people who need a home, God's people who have spent 40 years homeless, living in tents, wandering in the wilderness. Now they have the promise of a new life and a fresh start in a new land. But it is up to them to grasp this at this turning point. For just living in a new country isn't enough. The people have to change too. They have to live life God's way, to follow his commandments, to live a life of wisdom and goodness, which others will be able to see too. And the thing about this new way of life is that it is all-encompassing, and the heart of it is in the family. It is all about character formation through the generations. It is all about passing wisdom and goodness on. For the longed-for country is not so much a different place, but a different way of being, a different character, a changed heart within people. In this passage, there is a deep and crucial concern for the following generations. Verse 9 says, "But take care and watch yourselves closely, so as neither to forget the things that your eyes have seen, nor to let them slip from your mind all the days of your life. Make them known to your children and your children's children." I think not forgetting things but remembering them is not only about words, but it's about pictures. To help the people remember, Moses took them back to a particular moment and experience. He gave them a visual picture of being in the desert before a huge mountain of fire and smoke, a moment never to be forgotten. For us, remembering those who have died and suffered in war, it's a visual matter too. It's about wearing a red poppy. It's about being part of a crowd walking down the high street in Tranent and standing silently at 11 o'clock with so many others. It's about watching television and seeing others do the same thing all over the country. It's about paying attention to the names of those who have died in the memorials in our towns and in our churches. We pass the war memorial in this church each time we come in and out, and we remember the names on that memorial, particularly today. But remembering is also about the stories told in families, of the old and young, telling stories and listening to stories. It's about speaking to older people about their own memories so long ago of war. These small snatches are all important. Speaking to some older people this week, their memories were about war in Tranent, of the troops actually being stationed in McMerry, but of coming to Tranent to spend what little leisure time they had and what little money they had. I think in telling stories, we teach our young people about the best in human nature. And when it is so easy for them simply to hear stories about the worst in human nature in the news today. So we have the choice to talk about the possibility of goodness, to talk about the possibility of peace instead of the possibility of war, and to talk about those experiences which give us hope, in courage, and in the goodness of the human character. I think that the stories behind the award of the Victoria Cross, this country's highest military honour, do something of that. And so very few of these awards are made. For they are made for extreme bravery carried out under direct enemy fire. One was awarded to Lance Corporal Joshua Leakey in 2015 for rescuing his friends while fighting in Afghanistan. He was aged only 27 of the parachute regiment, and he was part of a joint US-UK helicopter raid in 2013. Leaving the helicopters, they found themselves pinned down by machine gun fire and rocket-propelled grenades from the Taliban in Helmand province. He chose to take the lead, and he chose to run across an exposed hillside, raked with machine gun fire three times to arrange the evacuation of casualties, to encourage his comrades, to return fire, and to retake the initiative. He was the first living soldier to receive the Victoria Cross for the war in Afghanistan. Do you know, he was awarded for something he didn't have to do. But he made a choice to risk his own safety and life to help others. I often think that none of us know how we're going to act until such a moment arrives. But in that moment, he showed the best of human nature and the best of the human character. I know about this story because it's visible. It's been reported in the news. There's a visible sign of a medal of the Victoria Cross. It's one I can hear and read about and then reimagine. But we know that there are countless other invisible stories of the bravery of people that we don't know who will have done similar things and have simply not been recognised for it. But listening and sharing stories such as these, I think, leads us to hope about human nature and the future of the world. For whatever the ending of the conflict in Afghanistan, accounts of bravery and courage, goodness and love remain. They shine out. Stories of people willing to give their lives for others. As Jesus did, as we hear in the New Testament reading today. Jesus was teaching his disciples and his friends just before his death. He knew that he was going to be leaving them, and he wanted them to remember what he had taught them about life. He says, "This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends." Jesus speaks of this special divine love, of the sort of love that deeply wants good for another person, that deeply wants that person to be free to be the best person they can possibly be, the sort of love that we can only learn over a lifetime. I think that this is the purpose of remembering today. The purpose is to talk about and to pass on how to live life with that special kind of love for others, and to pass it on to our children and their children too. In each of our ordinary days, one conversation and one action at a time. Despite the difference in culture between the generations, let's end with the hymn we started with, "I Vow to Thee, My Country." Do you know, the words are from a different age, a different culture almost, from a time when women had only just got the vote, and they can jar with some people. The words were created exactly 100 years ago in 1921. And yet, I think that they still speak to us today. For a country is a place, but more than that, a country is a people. And the picture with the hymn is not of one country, but of the whole world revolving round, and we can imagine all the billions of people in it. A whole world connected as we understand now as never before, through virus and through climate change. Looking at the words in the light of our readings today, our hope and our future is to show our love for other people above any love for a country, and to pass that love on to our children in the hope and promise of peace. But take care and watch yourselves closely, so as neither to forget the things that your eyes have seen, nor to let them slip from your mind all the days of your life. Make them known to your children and your children's children. Amen. Our next hymn is the hymn, Dear Lord and Father of Mankind. Let us pray with the words of a prayer from the churches together in Britain and Ireland. Let us pray for all who suffer as a result of conflict and ask that God may give us peace. We pray for the servicemen and women who have died in the violence of war, each one remembered by and known to God. May God give peace. We pray for those who love them in death as in life, offering the distress of our grief and the sadness of our loss. May God give peace. We pray for all members of the armed forces who are in danger this day, remembering family, friends, and all who pray for their safe return. May God give peace. We pray for civilian women, children, and men whose lives are disfigured by war or terror, calling to mind in penitence the anger and hatreds of humanity. May God give peace. We pray for peacemakers and peacekeepers who seek to keep this world secure and free. May God give peace. We pray for all who bear the burden and privilege of leadership, political, military, and religious, asking for gifts of wisdom and resolve in the search for reconciliation and peace. May God give peace. O God of truth and justice, we hold before you those whose memory we cherish and those whose names we will never know. Help us to lift our eyes above the torment of this broken world and grant us the grace to pray for those who wish us harm. As we honour the past, may we put our faith in your future. For you are the source of life and hope, now and forever. Amen. Our final hymn in our service this morning is the hymn, Your Hand, O God, Has Guided. Let us go out from this day in peace and love, and may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you all now, today and forevermore. Amen.